Our lecture number two, and the first part of the lecture two is the capital market line, a basic introduction. As we have studied before, that in our previous classes about the efficient frontier we have, and in the efficient frontier, this is the minimum variance portfolio, and this is basically the efficient frontier. This area downside, which goes below the minimum variance portfolio, is not an efficient frontier. We only take this as an efficient frontier, and in order to get these optimum points, and we don't want to get these points that are inefficient, so, we applied the Markowitz critical line algorithms. And we using that algorithm, we only get these points that are above the minimum variance portfolio. Minimum variance portfolio is that portfolio, that point, that if you draw a tangent, it becomes the tangent line is a parallel line with the y-axis. That means it's got a slope of 1 upon 0. That's infinity. Then we can build efficient frontiers using short sales allowed and short sale not allowed. If we apply the only condition that all weights are equivalent to 1, that means short sales is allowed. That means we can take negative weights also. And if we apply, if our weights are greater than 0, that means we are amplifying equivalent or equal to 0, that means we are amplifying that short sale is not allowed. Either case, we get the efficient frontier, and the efficient frontier is more or less, the difference is over here, because over here we normally get the minimum variance portfolio. The difference is not significant over here, but the when we move increase the risk and the return also, these things becomes evident. The difference between short sales allowed and short sales not allowed. When we allow the short sale, what happens? Our efficient frontier expands. Then this is what Markowitz contributed. Then came in Tobin, and Tobin use the liquidity preference theory. That is a very famous, and you have to study that thing. What is the liquidity preference theory, the details of it? Basically, liquidity preference theory says investors prefer the liquid assets, and as we move towards the non-liquid assets, if you say this is a liquid asset, this point, if you move away from this, then they need some compensation. In other words, the most liquid of all asset is basically your cash. This is the, and cash has a very as a characteristic that its risk is zero and its return is also zero. A $100 note was and today and will be of $100 value. That's another thing. Its intrinsic value might change because of the its value might change because of the time value of money, but basically its intrinsic value is the same. It remains 100 and is and will be always. So what happens? Its return is zero and its risk is also zero. But as we move away, so when we add non-liquid, we are moving from liquid to non-liquid assets. So what is happening? We will demand some compensation for it. That's why we don't move along the x-axis line. We are moving in this sort of a direction, where for a given level of risk, we want to get some return. Okay? As the risk is increasing, we demand, we expect more return because of the positive risk and return, risk and return relationship. And that relationship can be linear and can be non-linear. Over here in the efficient frontier, it's a non-linear relationship. So Tobin, there was a कि पीपल वांट इन्वेस्टर वांट्स टू प्रेफर कैश बट एज वी मूव अवे फ्रॉम द कैश वी वांट कंपनसेशन एंड दैट दिस प्रॉब्लम हैज बीन सॉल्व बाय द एफिशिएंट फ्रंटियर. व्हाट टोबिन डिड ही ट्राइड टू मूव दिस एफिशिएंट फ्रंटियर टू द पॉइंट वेयर वी गेट द कैश दैट इज मूविंग. व्हाट विल हैपन कि इफ यू मूव द वी आर एबल टू मूव द एफिशिएंट फ्रंटियर फ्रॉम हेयर टू द कैश साइज व्हाट विल हैपन फॉर द सेम लेवल ऑफ रिटर्न वी माइट गेट फॉर द सेम लेवल ऑफ रिस्क वी माइट गेट हायर रिटर्न्स दैट्स गुड इनफ और फॉर द सेम लेवल ऑफ रिटर्न वी कैन गेट लो रिस्क दैट्स वेरी इट्स एन आइडियल सिचुएशन. बट व्हाट ही डिड ही एडेड ही सेड व्हेन वी मूव टूवर्ड्स द लिक्विडिटी साइड सो व्हाट वी कैन डू वी कैन गो फॉर अ टू फंड वी कैन अप्लाई द टू फंड सेपरेशन थ्योरम. इट वॉज ओरिजिनली प्रेजेंटेड बाय फिशर फिशर एफ आई एस एच ई एच ई आर एंड इट सेज बेसिकली वी से कि वी इन्वेस्ट इन टू एसेट वन इज द रिस्की एसेट्स एंड वन वी गेट द नॉन रिस्क फ्री एसेट्स इन रिस्क फ्री एसेट और नॉन रिस्की एसेट. बेसिकली इन रिस्क फ्री मीन्स वी स्टार्ट विद कैश ओवर हियर सो द कैश इज द रिस्क फ्री एसेट ओवर हियर. सो व्हेन वी एड कैश वी एंड वी ड्रॉ अ टेंजेंट लाइन फ्रॉम हेयर टू हेयर दिस इज द टेंजेंट पॉइंट वी गेट वी कॉल इट टी टेंजेंट पॉइंट फ्रॉम हियर. ओके गुड इनफ. नाउ व्हाई नॉट मूव वन अहेड अहेड कि ओके व्हाई नॉट लुक फॉर आई विल कम टू दिस पॉइंट बिकॉज दिस विल बी बिकमिंग वेरी फजी ओवर हियर. ओके दिस इज द कैश साइड इफ यू ड्रॉ टेंजेंट लाइन फ्रॉम हेयर इट्स गुड इनफ. सो व्हाट अबाउट द पॉइंट्स ओवर हेयर दीज पॉइंट्स आर बेसिकली अनअटेनेबल पॉइंट्स. व्हाट अबाउट पॉइंट ओवर ओवर एक्स एक्सिस वाई एक्सिस बिकॉज व्हाट हैपन्स दैट मीन्स देर इज रिस्क जीरो रिस्क ओवर हेयर एंड देर इज सम रिटर्न. As we move away from, as we move along the x-axis, it means there is no return, but we've got more risk in it. So this does not solve a purpose. But if we move along the y-axis from the origin point, it says that we've got the risk is zero, but the return is theoretically is this there can be an asset? Yes, theoretically it's possible, and if you take it. We take any point over here that is x and draw a tangent. Okay, now we draw start. For example, we call it this point as x, and we start drawing a tangent point. We get a good point over here. And what this point is implying, this line is implying, we can get for this level of risk, we can get this return. Previously, the minimum risk. Return and risk relationship was up to here. That is the minimum. That means we cannot decrease the risk. This is the point, threshold point. We cannot decrease the risk and we can move towards the origin point. But when we draw a line from this x-axis, what happened? We had some return. For a lower level of risk, that was not. And again, if you move away also, for a given level of risk, we were getting this much return over here. But now, this line is providing us more return. That means we are getting more efficient. And same for here, for a given level of risk, we were getting this much return. But now, we are getting this much. So, there is the differential is there. So, this is an added advantage. That Tobin has given. Now this theoretical point is x. Now if there is any asset in the world having zero risk and giving some return, so theoretically is possible, but practically normally we do not. So why not take a proxy for it? When the original asset is not there, so we take a proxy, and the proxy is the treasury bills. It is basically we assume that the governments, they issue treasury bills in the short term. Treasury bills are those debt instruments that are issued in the short term on the short term basis. Issued in the short term on the short term basis. That is for 3 months, 6 months, 9 months, within a year. And normally we assume governments do not default on treasury bills. It's a very rare case. You can take the example of Brazil to a certain extent, and this thing is very rare. So we can take the risk. So take a proxy of this risk-free rate having some return on it. Okay, sorry. So these T-bills can solve our problem. These T-bills can serve us our purpose by giving the return, for example, they've got in Pakistan nowadays, it is 13.25 is the treasury bill. And in America, it might be 3 to 5%. I don't know nowadays what is going on, but it is what I have the knowledge is 2-3, and in Western countries it's up to 5%. But in Pakistan, it's 13.25. Though they have decreased it, but it is not a substantial thing. So this point is a point where you are getting some return, but there is no risk associated. Now what we do, we bring a tangent point from this risk-free asset, that is the using the T-bills, and we get this cap, this line, and we call it capital market line. This is that line which gives us a superior, it's an efficient frontier. It's an efficient frontier which depicts a linear risk-return relationship. Markowitz gave us a non-linear risk-return relationship. This line gives us a linear risk-return relationship, and applying two fund separation theorem. So we've got the tangent point over here. So this is the one fund separation theorem is over there, and if you move away in either direction, it gives us a two fund separation theorem. So giving to the details of it, so what is happening, this is our risk-free asset, and this is the risk premium we are charging for the risk. That means there is no risk. This is the return we will get for a risk-free. And as we this is the point where we get the risk-free return. As we move towards the x-axis, move along, then the premium is charged and we get this point, the CML line. And this is an efficient frontier one. Just remember, this is a point normally taken as T, unless until we convert it, it's not. Is known as the tangent point, and if we apply the two fund separation theorem, what is happening over here, we get the lending and the borrowing side, and that means the point tangent represents the risky assets, and as we move up, so what we happening, we are adding a portfolio to our risky assets by borrowing funds at risk-free rate. That means we are investing in two assets. One is the risky assets and the second is the risk-free asset by borrowing funds. As we move down the line, what is happening? We are again investing in risky assets, and we are also investing in risk-free asset by lending. This is the lending side, this is the borrowing side. By borrowing funds, we are in the risk-free assets at risk-free rate, and we are lending at risk-free rate. So combining these two, we get our total portfolio. In other words, now this has become a two fund separation theorem. Two funds mean we are increasing and we are investing in risk-free and risky assets. This is risk-free and risky assets. This is two fund, and this staging point represents one fund separation theorem because we are only investing in risky assets over here. This is that point where all this is the point at the efficient frontier line. And if you remember, efficient frontier line is only prepared is prepared only using the risky assets, not risk-free assets. So tangent point will carry the risky assets, but if you move along the line, we will be divesting or investing, that is lending or borrowing at risk-free rate. What does separation theorem mean? That means two fund separation theorem, okay, that your borrowing decision is different from your investing decision. So investment decision is this line and borrowing is your preference decision. That is the indifference curves over here. Same as that was in the efficient frontier, we studied the separation theorem was applied over there. Investment decision is the fresh is the efficient frontier line, and our borrowing, that means our preference decision, is the second the part. The separation is your preference is using the indifference over here. Same goes over here. When we build a CMN line, we can go for different indifference curves, and we can find out our preference over here. The tangent point, moving above the tangent point, represents more less risk averse investor. Risk averse are there, but they are risky. Moving down the tangent point means we are more risk averse, because when we become more risk averse, we tend to lend. When we become less risk averse, we tend to borrow. That's the point. Now, what we have to do this, okay, this is the, if you say this is the angle theta over here, and we how to calculate the CML line. So this is the way, this is the method, this is the way we have, we can calculate draw the CML line. And this is your assignment also, that you can take make a portfolio, you can take the RF rate, take the treasury bills rate, then you can calculate the variance, the standard deviation of the portfolio, and eventually putting that thing into the equation, you can maximize theta. Theta is this angle, and as we move up, I'll go back again to this area where we were. Look over here, we've got different lines over here. We've got three lines. We start to optimize. So we'll get this line. Over here is more. We start with this line. We've got a suboptimal market line, and we keep on going until we get the tangent point. If you get a line over and above, this is in the unattainable side. So the last point would be the tangent point over here. So to get the tangent point, we optimize this thing with the condition over here. And now this means short sales are allowed. When we say your weights are equivalent to or greater than zero, that means short sale is not allowed. So